Hey guys, what's going on? It's Blaze from Funbox here, and in today's video, we are going to round off, that's right, we're going to finish off the core, I guess, of the player or the game maker tutorial series about line of sight. And this one, we're going to actually work on the player's line of sight. The last three videos, we were working on enemy line of sight. This time, I thought we could do it for the player instead. So this is what we're going to make today. It's going to look something like this, or hopefully it's going to look exactly the same. But before we get into this video, let's just go over a couple of things today. Yes, it is ad time. If you guys want to support this channel, all you have to do is subscribe and leave a like for each of our videos here. If you guys have any suggestions for future tutorial content or stuff that you want us to do on this channel, then leave a comment in the comment section below. We are planning to do a game analysis video, and we're looking for indie games for us to play and have a look at in greater detail. So if you have any suggestions for those, then I would really appreciate it. Of course, if you want to support us financially, you can. We do have cryptocurrency donations. You can find links to those in the description below. Or if you want to donate by PayPal or by using regular money, I guess, you might have to wait a little bit longer. Every single dollar helps the channel out. I'm hoping to be able to do video content daily, but at the moment, I kind of have to put my job first, considering YouTube doesn't exactly pay out that much. Anyway, doesn't matter about that. Let's just get into this. If you want to follow along with this tutorial directly, we do have a project template that will also be in the comments and in the description, so you can just grab that there. You can, of course, use your own project if you want to. It just might take a little bit of fiddling around. So for those of you who want to use the template, go grab it now. Okay, that was enough time for you guys to go get it. So hopefully you do have it and you're ready to go. We should have in the templates, you should have 1, 2, 3, 5 sprites. You should have 4 objects if you don't have enough. Doesn't matter. All we really need for today's video is actually just the player and the enemy objects. You should also have a room. Before we get started, let's open up this room here. And I want to draw your attention to the instances layer and the properties here. Please take careful note that for our version of this line of sight today, the player has to be at the bottom of the list. The reason being because all of the code that we will be writing will be in the player. Is it the right way to do it? Yes, it's definitely one way to do things. But is it the way that I would recommend if you're going to scale it up? Unfortunately, it depends on the size of your game, so it's going to be different for everybody. So for our demonstration, we're just going to have the player at the very bottom of the instances list, and you just click and drag them to change the location. So let's close that out. In the template, you're going to have certain events for the enemy, and that's because for the enemy, in the last three videos, we were programming for the enemy's actions. This time, seeing as we don't need them, we don't need to have them at all. So you can just delete all of the code for the enemy there. The player, however, should have 4 events. If they are not written in, please write them in. So you should have, if they're not there, then please remember to put them into the object. So we've got 4 events. We've got the create, destroy, step, and draw. Now, don't worry about any of these comments that I've got. These are my notes, and we are going to be following them for today's tutorial. So here in the create event, let's just go through this real quick. We've got some basic movement variables, and in the step event, we should have a basic moving. The rest, like I said, are all comments, and we are going to be filling those comments in today. But let's start first with the create event for the player. Now, for this, to create a vision cone, we obviously need to have a triangle. And a triangle for GameMaker Studio needs 3 points. Each of these 3 points needs an X value and a Y value. So for us, we're going to have X1, Y1. For point 2, we're going to have naturally X2 and Y2. And for point 3, you guessed it, X3 and Y3. All right, let's set some default values for these guys. So we're going to say X1 is X, whoops, and we're going to make Y1 as Y. I think that makes sense. X2 will have let's make our character face right first. So bbox right plus, I'm going to use 64. The reason why I'm using 64 is because during the testing for this version of it, I just felt that it made sense. So you can change it to whatever, you can change this value to whatever you want. In fact, you don't have to code it this way. This is just for demonstration purposes. For Y2, we're going to use bbox. Bbox top. Remember, it needs to go up, so we need to go minus, and we're going to go minus 16. And for X3, we're going to do it the same as X2. So bbox right plus 64. And we're going to make Y3 bbox bottom plus 16. All right. Now, that's fairly straightforward. I think it makes sense. Let's create the global surface, actually. This global surface is going to hold all the information that we will need to create that top orange layer that we saw in the demo earlier. So for this, we're going to create a global variable. So global dot, and we'll call it surface. That's because for today, we will be creating, we will be working with surfaces. If you've never worked with surfaces before, you can leave a comment and I will try and run through a surfaces tutorial with you guys at some point. Hopefully within a couple of weeks, but we'll have to wait to see if everything's all right at work for that. Anyway, for global surface, we are going to say surface underscore create. And it needs a width and height. What I'm going to use is room width and room height. Fairly simple line of code there. All right, so that's all of it there. We've got three points for our triangle. Each of those points has an X and Y value. And we've created a surface. We've stored that in the global variable called global surface. None of this will have any effect on our game at the moment. In fact, if we play the game right now, as it is, nothing will happen. We won't even see the player. And that's because we have a draw event, but we have nothing written in it. So for us, let's get started with some programming first. If we're moving right, actually, you know what? Let's not put in this at the moment. Let's focus here in the draw event. And that's because this is where most of the things will be happening. So let's have a look at these first two lines. Always check to see if the surface exists. If not, then make a new one. So obviously the first thing we're going to have to do is say if not surface exists, and we are going to, it needs an ID, so naturally global.surface. Then we need to create a new one. So global.surface equals surface underscore create, and of course it needs a width and a height, so room width and room height. There we go, all done. Now let's have a look at this next line. Else we do all this stuff, so naturally else, let's put in the opening and closing brackets down here. Let's put them automatically so that we don't forget to do them later. Now here's a really important point. These two lines here, set surface target, and this line here, surface reset target. Now you can see here, with this line here, what I've written here is surface reset target acts as a closing brace for surface drawing. In the same way, set surface target acts as an opening brace. Basically what these two squiggly brackets are, they're called braces. When it comes to drawing surfaces, these next two lines of code that we are going to write are basically extra braces, right? Don't worry too much if you don't understand it. Like I said, if you want me to do a tutorial on working with surfaces, all you have to do is leave a comment and I will get to it as soon as I can. So let's create our target here. So let's type surface set target. Now set target, we are going to say global.surface. Done. And then at the bottom, down here, again, you can just type this in. We're just going to fill in the blanks as we go. We're going to say surface reset target. Done. Now, it doesn't need any arguments. It's just as it is. We're just going to call it. Now, if we play the game, there won't be any differences. like I said, nothing's going to be different. So unfortunately, that's just how it is. Okay, so for us to actually be able to create that blackout effect, in this case, it's actually more of an orange out. For us to be able to do that, we need to actually draw our blackout sprite. So let's do that. Let's type it in. We're going to type it in just like we would drawing any normal sprite. So draw a sprite, and I'm going to use tiled. Yep, I'm going to use just the basic tiled. You can, of course, use sprite tiled ext or extended, but we don't want to have to work with too many variables here today. We just want to keep it simple, super simple. Now it needs a sprite, so I'm going to use vblock. You can use whatever blackout, you can use a black square if you want. We're going to need to put in a sub image, so whichever one it wants. And we also need an x and a y. Now the x and the y is how far do we want to draw these things. And for us, we're going to use room width and room height. Oh, whoops. That should be a comma, not a dot. Okay, so there we go. That's fine. Nothing's going to happen yet. Let's do another run just to prove something. And that's because we haven't actually drawn the surface. So on this last line down here, we need to draw everything that happens in between these two lines. How do we do that? Well, we just type in draw surface. And there it is, surface. And it needs three parameters. It needs the ID, which for us is global.surface. And it needs an X and a Y. And these are the origin points. So for us, for most people, it would be the case of 0 and 0. That's because in our case, we need it to cover the entire space. So let's play the game now, and it should come up with our orange blocks instead of those light gray blocks. Sorry if that hurt your eyes a bit, guys. I wasn't really thinking about the color there. But that's basically our foundation for it. Now, for us, we need to do a little bit... Now, for us to actually start drawing things like the character and to create that vision cone and that vision circle effect, we need to fill in the rest of this section here. So let's do that right now. Now, the first line here is set the blend mode to subtract. For that, we need to type in GPU set blend mode. There it is, the second one for me. And we are using BM subtract. Done. Whoops, we don't need that. Okay, so BM subtract basically says that, hey, whatever the next line is, it's going to cut that out of the surface. So for us, in this case, we are going to, let's say, draw circle. We're going to use X, Y. We need a radius now. I'm going to use a radius of 16 for us. And then I'm going to use an outline false because we want to be able to see what's inside of the circle, not just that. Now let's draw the triangle. We might as well draw the triangle now, just so that we know what we're doing. Draw circle 16 false. The next one is draw. You might have already guessed it. Draw triangle. And this is the one we're going to use. We're going to use x1, y1, x2, y2, and then x3, y3. And do we need an outline? No, we don't. Now, all of these variables that we're using here, we've already set them up here in the create event. However, we're going to continue to update them as we move around in the step event. However, we haven't done anything like that yet. The next thing that we need to do, actually, no, let's show this now. Oh, nothing happened. And that's perfectly normal because we haven't actually done anything. And that's because what we need to do is we actually need to set the blend mode back to normal. So basically what's happening is the GPU, we set it to subtract and it's just subtracting everything. Nothing's happening. That's why we need to set it back to normal, as this line says. And for that, you might already have guessed, we're going to say GPU set blend mode, and then we're going to use BM normal. Right, so don't freak out if you test the game. using BM subtract, and it comes up as a black screen. It's just because we haven't done anything with it. So there you go. We have our triangle. We have our circle here, which creates that sort of that effect, that close range effect. But what happens when we move? The triangle doesn't follow us, and that's because we haven't updated those positions yet. We also don't see the character sprite, so we might as well add that in right now. And for that, all we really need to do is say draw self. Okay, I feel like I should test it out for you guys just to prove a point. And there you go, we have our character inside of his vision circle, inside the vision cone, but again, we don't have programming for the vision cone, so it's just permanently stuck there. That's okay, we don't need to worry about that. The reason why he's off-center is because the sprite is so small that he's actually just, the origin is off-center for the sprite as well. So if you're using your own project, your sprites should be a different shape and it should work out just fine. But anyway, for us, we are going to start programming in this entire section here. It's fairly straightforward. So let's have a look here. If moving right, so if our x-axis is greater than 0, then we're going to do some stuff, right? And let's fill in the skeleton first, actually. Else if moving left, so else if x-axis is less than 0, we're going to do some other stuff. Now, let's put in an extra space down here. If moving down, so for this one, if y-axis is greater than 0, do some stuff. And else if y-axis is less than 0, i.e. we are moving upwards, we're going to do some other stuff. Now that we have the skeleton, you can kind of fill in the blanks almost by yourself. But just to make it easy for you guys, let's work through this together. So x1, we want it to be on the right side, so I'm going to use bbox right. And we want y1 to be set basically at where the player is in terms of the y position. So we're just going to set that to y. Now for the offsets, x2, y2, x3, and y3, we're going to say x2, y2, x3, and y3. Now I don't normally want to do this copy-pasting, but I don't want to have to type out x2, y2, x3, y3 every single time. That just gets really, really tedious. So for this one, we're going to say x2. So for x2, remember, we are moving right. We need it to be at bbox right plus 64. Now, like I said, you can change the 64 to be whatever value you want. So for y2, we need that to be above the player. This won't change for left or right, actually. The y values, I mean. They won't change for, they won't change for moving left and right. Similarly for y, the x values won't change either. So for y2, we're going to say bbox top minus 16. For x3, we're going to use bbox right plus 64. Now, just before I keep going, you can actually say x3 equals y2. That's perfectly fine. The reason why we are doing it this way is because, I don't know, some people might want to have some fun-shaped vision cones or something, or maybe you want some irregular shapes. That's perfectly fine. And that's really why I'm doing it this way. But yeah, you can just simply say x3 equals x2. That's perfectly fine. Y3 is bbox bottom plus 16. Now, like I said, I don't want to have to copy paste, but I'll break my rule this one time because I don't like writing this code. I hate writing code like this. It's as in repetitive code. It's really, really tedious. For this one, x1 is on the left side. So let's go bbox left, naturally. y1 stays the same. So y1 equals bbox. We're going to say y. Yeah, it's really, really tedious. Now for x2, we are going to say bbox left. And instead of plus 64, we need to make it minus 64. Because remember, we're moving left in this case. Now, B-box top stays the same and B-box bottom stays the same. However, this one goes B-box left again, minus 64. So that's how it is there. Let's have a look at that and let's see if it works. We don't want to have to make too many mistakes. So there we go. We have left and right movement. But if we move up, you can see that nothing happens, right? And if we move down, nothing happens either. It only works when we're moving left or right, which is fine. That makes sense. Okay, for now that we're moving vertically, that is up and down, we need to change this. So X1 is now going to be X. And Y1 is on the bottom because we are moving down. So Y1 equals B box bottom. And then, yes, I know, shame on me. All right, so for this, instead of the, up here, we had the Y values stay constant. For vertical movement, the X values are going to stay constant. So X2 will always be left plus 16, and X3 will always be right plus 16. Now, for Y2, we need to say B-box bottom plus 64, and that needs to be 64 as well. Again, yes, I know, I don't want to have to copy and paste. I don't like copying and pasting, but yeah. I don't know why I keep mentioning that. I'll stop. All right, so for this one, X1 will stay the same because we are still moving up and down. In this case, however, XY, because we're moving up, needs to be B box top. Now, some people were saying, like, where do I find things like the OR symbol, like this symbol, right? I use a Japanese keyboard, so I can't tell you. I've been using a Japanese keyboard for a long time. So, unfortunately, you guys will have to figure it out for even US users. I've completely forgotten where the keys are for the US keyboards, and I kind of have to look at the keyboard now. So for Y2, we need to use B-box top, and because we're moving up, we need to use minus 64. And B-box top, minus 64. So let's play the game now, and let's hope that everything works. We go left, right, up, ooh, and down. What's going on here? Oh, I see. So for, where are we? This is why I don't like doing it. So for B-box left, it should be minus 16. B-box left should be minus 16. That's why it was kind of like half a triangle because, well, we had plus 16 instead of minus 16. We needed to move that point leftwards, but instead it was going rightwards. Now there's one more thing that we need to do. In the destroy event, what we actually have to do is we need to tell the game, we need to tell the engine to say, hey, we don't need to use the surface anymore, we should delete it. Now this is to keep the game from crashing, because if you can imagine, you might have 3-4 different surfaces, and if one's not being used, it's a waste of memory. You want to keep your game file as small as possible without compromising it, and this is just one way to free up memory, as this line says here. So to do that, we are going to type in surface underscore free, and it just needs one parameter, and that's the ID, that's global dot surface, and we're all done. That's it. This will produce for us, we can just play it here. There we go. We have our invisible enemies that we won't see until the last minute, or we run into them or something like that. Now, you might be wondering, can I make this for my mouse? Can we make it for mouse control? Absolutely. Yes, you can. Instead of using your triangle, instead of using B-box right or B-box up or whatever like that, you can simply use mouse X or mouse Y for that. And it should have the same functionality. If you guys do want me to make a tutorial for that, I would be more than happy to do that with you guys. All you have to do is leave a comment below asking for it, and I'll get on it as soon as I can. But for now, guys, that's it. Remember to leave a like and comment what you guys want us to cover here on the Funbox channel. We are actually training somebody new to help contribute. Nick's doing exams right now, so one like equals one prayer. Anyway, guys, that's all from me, and I hope to see you in the next one. Bye-bye.